I will show you how we will create a pulsus, first in Suleiman and then in all of you. And we'll demonstrate how to do it in everybody. That's why we got blood pressure cuffs, is everybody's going to walk out of here hopefully comfortable in measuring it. Okay, so so what you're trying to do, so this is pressure, time. Okay, so this is what it's looking like, right? So this is, somebody is exhaling, somebody is inhaling. Okay, smaller pulse pressure. When you, what you're trying to detect, when you say their pulsus is such and such, you're trying to detect what is the difference in these two numbers. Okay, so if this is greater than 10, now you would consider it significant, 10 millimeters of mercury. All right, so how to measure that? Well, you inflate a cuff above this level, just as you would for taking anyone's blood pressure, and you gradually release it. And once you get to this, yeah, first Korotkoff sound, so you'll hear. But so normally, let's say somebody's heart rate was, you know, normal heart rate, you'd hear, right, with their heartbeat. But what happens here? Well, right when you get just below this sound, you're going to hear this, but you're not going to hear that. Draw on this as if every other beat it's different. The truth is, let me draw this more appropriately. People aren't breathing with every heartbeat, obviously, so it's going to go more like this. Okay? And so we're, again, talking about the difference between here and here. So what if you are kind of right around there on your cuff? Well, you're going to hear, right, so the sound is going to be loud here, maybe barely audible there, and then it's going to disappear until you get back above that. Okay, so what we're, so how to do it? You get above the pressure, you start going down on the cuff until you get right here, and that is the first number that you know. So let's say it's 118. And now you got to go really slowly, and then how do you know you're here? Yeah, you'll hear it every beat. Right? So the difference between hearing the very first sound and then you're hearing it every heartbeat, that's the difference. That's what you're measuring. A few rules and then we're going to demonstrate them, what I'll do. So number one, biggest, I'd say the number one mistake I see when people try to do this is that they're trying to look at the reading on the cuff and they're trying to watch the person's breathing to try to sort of correlate it. Well, hold on, they're breathing right now, it should be higher. Okay, good rule, people will breathe. Okay, so as long as you don't have them hold their breath, and there's no reason to have them hold their breath, they will breathe. So just go slowly, and as long as you're going slowly, you'll catch it in different phases of respiration. Okay, so don't even look at the breathing. Number two, I got at this, you got to go down slowly, because if just between beats you're dropping a few millimeters of mercury, then you're throwing way too much air in this. So sometimes, like, you don't even know where it's going to start, so you can pump it up to whatever, 180, you can come down quickly kind of just to get a sense of around where it is that you're going to be looking at, and then you start hearing something around 120, great. Now you pump it back up, and now go really slowly as you go between that, because again, these are the two numbers that we need, okay? Number three, if a person happens to have an A-line in, you know, they're in the ICU with an A-line, well, I hate to say it because this is a physical exam session, but you don't really need to do it if they have an A-line in. You can just look at the A-line, and you'll see a pulsus on people with an A-line not that infrequently if they have the right situation for it, so then use it. Even a sat monitor you can get a sense from, because remember, a sat monitor is a poor person's A-line, basically, and so you can see somebody with quite prominent pulsus, you'll see that get smaller, bigger and smaller with the respiratory cycle. Again, that you're not going to be able to get a number off of. The A-line, you can actually measure the pressure, but you can use the sat monitor. Okay. Number four, the rhythm must be regular. If somebody has an irregular rhythm, they're in AFib, or they're having ectopy all over the place, forget it, this doesn't work, right? Because now, if you have an irregular rhythm, the ventricle is going to be more or less full, dependent on how big the RR interval is. So you cannot measure a pulsus in somebody without a regular rhythm, okay? And then number five, if you are comfortable measuring a pulsus, which hopefully everybody will be as we finish this session, then you don't, ordering that echo to say, is there hemodynamic effect or hemodynamic compromise, it's actually not that important, because what they're looking at by echo is basically what you're measuring with pulsus. And in fact, one of the things that they look at when you're looking for hemodynamic effect is directly trying to look at the velocity of blood across the mitral valve as a surrogate for filling the left ventricle and stroke volume. Well, that's exactly what you're measuring the effect of when you're measuring a pulsus. So again, this is not just a parlor trick that you can pull out to impress people. This is actually quite clinically relevant if you have a person with a pericardial effusion and you're trying to get a sense of, is it tamponade or not? Do we need to send this person for drainage or not?